nada más con mejorando los presentes.
Are you ready? Yes. Okay. So welcome everybody to the third talk in this seminar series. And it is my pleasure to introduce today to Javier Gutiérrez. He works at Universidad de Barcelona as a Ramón y Cajal researcher, a very prestigious position in Spain, very difficult to get one. So today he is going to talk us about homotopy theory for operats and algebras.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for the invitation. So I'm going to try to share the screen. Let's see if this works.
Okay. Yes, we can see it.
Now, can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. So my talk is going to be more like an introductory or a survey talk on homotopy theory for operats. And by this, what I mean is just model structures for operats and operatic algebras. So what I'm going to explain is essentially contained in the following references. So the first one is the first of a series of papers on model structures for algebras and operas by Berger and Murdeck, who's publishing the commentary. There's some part that I'm going to explain, which is contained in the book by Fresh, which modules over operas and functors. And if I have time in the end, I will comment a small contribution that I made together with Rainer Vogt in the case of the category of spectra, so for operats in spectra. So as you know, operats are gadgets which are used to codify algebraic structures, and they are especially useful to describe homotopy invariant algebraic structures in categories where we have a good notion of homotopy. So what do we mean by this? So for instance, you can think in the category, so take the category of topological spaces, consider a topological monoid. So X is a topological monoid, and suppose that we have another space Y, which is weakly equivalent, homotopy equivalent to X. Then, in principle, we cannot transport the monoid structure from X to Y, but Y will not be a monoid in general, but this space Y will have what is called an A-infinity structure. And this space Y will be equivalent to X as A-infinity spaces. So this is an instance of what I mean by a homotopy invariant algebraic structure. Moreover, in this case, we also have that we can somehow rectify A-infinity spaces. So we have an A-infinity space X. There is always, we can find a monoid Y, which is really a strict monoid in the category of spaces, which is equivalent, homotopy equivalent to X. Okay, so what I'm going to explain in this talk today is how we can formalize this kind of properties, or how much of this statement, which falls in the category of topological spaces, can be extended to other categories. So what part of this is really formal, and what part of this it really depends that we are working in the category of spaces. Okay, so let's start with the setting that we are going to work in. So during the whole talk, C is going to be a co-complete closed symmetric monoidal category. So it means that we have a category C together with a tensor product. I is going to be the unit of the monoidal structure, and this home is going to be the internal home of the category. So for every two objects in C, home from, let's say, X to Y is going to be another object in C. Okay. So let me recall what an operand is. So probably all of you already know, but just to keep and fix the notation that I'm going to use. So operands can be defined in any such category. Whenever we have monoidal category, we find operands. Okay, and an operand consists of a sequence of objects in this category, which I have denoted by Pn for n bigger or equal than zero, together with a bit more structure. And this extra structure is for every n, we have an action of the symmetric group sigma n on each object Pn. We have a unit map, which is a map from the unit of the monoidal structure to the first term of the opera, to P1. And the third ingredient is the composition product, which is a map that goes from Pk, so tensor Pn1, Pnk, so we have n, k more objects, and it ends in the P of the sum of the indices n1 and k. This composition product has to be it has to be associative, and it has to be compatible with the action of the symmetric groups and with the units and so on. So it means that several diagrams commute. So I'm not writing all of them, but it's just it has to be compatible with the other ingredients. Okay, and once we have the objects, so we have to define what the morphisms are, and the morphism, a map of operands from P to Q, consists of maps for each n, from Pn to Qn, which are compatible with the composition product of each of the operands. Okay, so we are going to denote by upper C the category of operands in a monoidal, closed symmetric monoidal category C. Okay, so this is going to be our setting. And now, a few classical examples of operands. So the first one is the associative operand, that in every degree or in every arity, we have I of sigma n, which is just a coproduct of copies of the unit of the monoidal structure indexed by the elements of the symmetric group. So the symmetric group acts here by permutation. We have another example is the commutative operand, which is for every n, this is constant, this is the unit of the monoidal structure. And the third example is the endomorphism operand of an object. So for every object x in the monoidal category, we can define the endomorphism operand of this object. And in degree n, what we have is the internal home from x n times tensor n times the object of the category to itself. So once we have operands, we can define what a P algebra, or an algebra over P, is an object of the category together with a map of operands from P to the endomorphism operand of this object. If we unravel the definition, this is consists of maps for every m from Pn tensor x n times into x. Of course, they have to satisfy that these are maps of operands, so they have to be compatible with the composition product, the symmetric actions, and so on. And we are going to denote by alg pc the category of P algebras in C. Okay, so whenever we have a P algebra, an operand P, we can forget about part of the structure. So we can forget about the unit, and we can forget about the composition product. And what we get is what's called a symmetric collection. So it's just a collection of objects indexed by the natural numbers in the category, and each of these objects has an action of the symmetric group sigma n. We denote this category by col of C. This is the category of collections, and it's the same as taking the product category of C to the sigma n. So C to the sigma n are objects in C with an action of sigma n. And by convention, we assume that sigma zero is equal to sigma one, and is the trivial group. Okay. So another thing that we have is a free forgetful adjunction between these two categories, the category of collections and the category of operands. So the right adjoint is the forgetful factor. So we know we have an operand, we can forget unit and composition product, and we get a collection. And there is a left adjoint to this, which is, call it here F, which is the free operand on a collection. So whenever we have a collection, we can take a free construction and obtain an operand. Okay, and this adjunction is important because this is the one that we are going to use to put a model structure in the category of operands. So our first goal is to produce a model structure in this category OpenC. So how are we going to do this? We are going to use what's called the transfer theorem, which can be stated as follows. So this is a general procedure to produce a model structure from an adjunction. And what we have is we have the following situation. So we have a model structure, model category D, which is cofibral degenerated. And we have an adjunction with another category, C, which we assume is co-complete. Okay. And now what we want to do is we want to define a model structure on C from the model structure that we have on D. And we want to do this in a way that the functor U detects the weak equivalences and the fibrations in C. So the idea is the following. We can define a map in, well, for model category, we have to say what are, to define a model category, we have to give three families of maps, the cofibrations, weak equivalences, and fibrations, and then we have to check that they satisfy a list of actions. Okay. So in this case, we have this structure on D, and we're going to transport it to C. And the way we do it is we define a map in C to be a weak equivalence or a fibration if it's detected by this right adjoint. In other words, if U of F is a weak equivalence or a fibration in the model structure on D. Okay. So we can define these maps, and then we can ask if this gives or does not give a model structure on C. And the transfer theorem tells us that this is the case if we have some nice conditions. So under nice conditions, this gives a model structure on C, which is called the transfer model structure. Okay. So I'm not going to specify what are these nice conditions in general, but I will tell what we need in our case of interest. So now we are going to use this theorem, and we're going to apply it to this adjunction here. Okay, so the first thing we need is of course a model structure on this category of collections, which plays the role of this D in the theorem. Okay, so we start with C, which is a cofibral degenerated monoidal model category. We're going to put a model structure on the operands on C. So what is the model structure we take for the category of collections? So recall that this category is this product category. So it's the product of this C to the sigma n, which are objects in C with an action of sigma n. And so what we do is we can take the projective model structure on C to the sigma n. So projective model structure means that a map in this category is a fibration and a weak equivalence if it is so when we forget the action of the symmetric group. And then for the big product, we just take the product model structure, which defines fibrations, weak equivalences, and cofibrations level-wise. This is a cofibral degenerating model structure in the category of collections. And this is the one that we are going to transfer to operands. Okay. So the first theorem that we have is in the case of when C is not just a monoidal category, but it's a Cartesian model category, which means that the monoidal tensor product is the Cartesian product. So C is a cofibral degenerated Cartesian model category. And the assumptions that we need are the following. So we need first that the terminal object of the category has to be cofibrant. and that the category C has a symmetric monoidal fibrant replacement function. So every model category, consider that we have factorial factorizations, has a fibrant replacement factor, but in this case we are also asking that this factor has to be symmetric monoidal. Okay, so if these two conditions are satisfied, then the category of operands in C admits a transfer model structure, which means that we have a model structure on operands in C such that the weak equivalences and vibrations are detected by the forgetful factor. So it essentially means that a map from operas from P to Q is a weak equivalence or a vibration if for every n, Fm from Pn to Qn is a weak equivalence or a vibration in C for all C. Okay. So once we have the vibrations and the weak equivalences, in general, we can determine the co-vibrations by a lifting property as usual. Okay, but this theorem only works when the category is Cartesian. So if we want to do it more general, that it's also possible, but we have to restrict a bit the class of operas to which we can apply. So this is slightly more general for the category, but slightly more restrictive for the operand. So now we have a co-fibrant generated monoidal model category. And we assume the following. We assume that the unit is co-fibrant, that every object under the unit has a symmetric monoidal fibrant replacement factor. So this category C over I is the slice category or the comma category. So the objects are maps from objects in C to Y, and the morphisms are commutative triangles. And the third condition is that C admits a commutative Hopf interval. So an interval is a factorization of the fold map from the unit coproduct with itself to the unit of the monoidal structure as a cofibration followed by a weak equivalence. And we ask essentially that this object A is a monoid and a comoda. Okay. Well, when we have this this situation, then we have a transfer model structure, but not in the category of all operands, but in the category of what they call reduced operands, which mean that the zero term of the operand is the unit. Okay. So you can define similarly a category of reduced collections. You have a similar adjunction as before. And if these conditions are satisfied, then you have a model structure, but only in this case. So but sometimes we would like to have this for all the operas, not just for the reduced ones. So can we do that? Well, in the first theorem, it's possible to replace Cartesian by monoidal, but then we have to add some extra conditions. Specifically, you have to add that the unit is cofibrant, and also that there is an interval with a coassociative and co-commutative co-multiplication. In this case, then the category of all operands in C will have a transfer model structure. Okay, so these are the general theorems. So let's see how we can apply this in examples, or where we can apply this theorem. So so the first case is the category of topological spaces with the Quillen model structure. So this satisfies the assumptions of the first theorem. So we have a transfer model structure for operands with values in topological spaces. The second case that also is of interest is the category of simplicial sets with the Kahn-Quillen model structure. In this case, what we get is a model structure with for operands with values in simplicial sets. And the third example is the category of chain complexes. In this case, we have a monoidal structure, so this one is not Cartesian, so we cannot apply the first theorem, we have to apply the second one. And if we take the projective model structure on chain complexes, then we get a model structure on reduced operands. Okay, so you have these three examples. So now let's see some non-examples. So let's see where we cannot apply directly this theorem. So the first case is operands in chain complexes for any ring R. We want to put a model structure in the full category of operands, so we cannot apply these theorems because some assumptions are not satisfied. But by other means, we can prove that the transfer model structure exists in this case if either one of these two conditions are satisfied. So we take R to be the, for instance, the rationals. Then it's true that the category of all operands has a transfer model structure in chain complexes. Or the second condition that we can impose is that we can restrict two operands such that with zero term is equal to zero. Okay, so non-unital operands. And another example that we cannot get from these theorems are the case of symmetric spectra, okay? Because for the stable category, there is no. It's a paper by Lewis, an old paper by Lewis, which says that there is no monoidal model structure for the stable category, which has a cofibrant unit and at the same time a symmetric monoidal fibrant replacement function. So one of the two conditions of the previous theorem has to fail. So we cannot apply this theorem to symmetric spectra, but we'll see how to trick to get this model structure by other means. Okay. So suppose that we have this. Let me go back to this adjunction. And suppose that fitting collection and operas. And suppose that you are not assuming anything, right? So, like in this transfer, I said that you have to assume some nice conditions. But so suppose you want to be have full generality, and you want to try to transfer this model structure from collections to operas. So how far can you go? So the answer is that you cannot prove the existence of a full model structure, but you get very close to that. And actually, what you get is what is called a semi-model structure, which is a weakening of the notion of model structure. But for many purposes, it's sufficient. Okay. So a semi-model structure on a category C is the same thing as a model structure, but we have to weaken two things: the lifting axiom and the factorization axiom. So. The lifting axiom for semi-model categories says that whenever we have a cofibration, or in other words, the cofibrations have the left lifting property with respect to the trivial fibrations, which is this first square here. So if we have a commutative square such that the map on the left is a cofibration and the map on the right is a trivial fibration, then we can find a lift. And the second part of the lifting axiom, which in general model categories is for trivial cofibrations and fibrations. So trivial cofibrations have the left lifting property with respect to fibrations. In a semi-model category, this holds only when the source of the trivial cofibration is a cofibrant object. Okay, so we have like kind of half of the lifting action. And for the factorization, is a bit the same. So any map, we can factor it as a cofibration followed by a trivial fibration, like in a model category. But we can only factor a map as a trivial cofibration followed by a fibration when the source of the map is cofibrant. Okay. But this is, as I said, this is enough for many purposes. For instance, if you have a semi-model structure, you can always build the cofibrant replacements because you only use this part of the factorization action. Okay. So we have the following theorem, which was proved by Spitzbeck in his thesis, that if you have a covariant generated model, monoidal model category, then the category of operands always admits a transfer semi-model structure. Okay, so there are no extra conditions here. We don't get a full model structure, but we get something which is very close to it. Okay, so we have developed this formalism of model structure for operands. Now let's see how we can interpret in this framework the homotopy invariance property, which I mentioned in the beginning. So the question is, so we have an object X in C, which is a p-algebra, and something that is weakly equivalent to it. Is Y also a p-algebra, or does it inherit a p-algebra structure from the one in X? Well, the first statement that we have, the statement that we have in this setting is the following. So we have a map from X to Y in C, and let's assume that we have a transfer model structure in the category of operands, okay? And the condition that the operand P is covariant in this model structure. So this is really important. So maybe you have heard the sentence that p-algebras are homotopy invariant if P is a covariant operand. So this is the model, that statement in terms of model categories, okay? So the first result that we get is that we have this map in C. So if X is a p-algebra, the object Y is fibrant, and the tensor of F with itself is a trivial cofibration, then the object Y admits a p-algebra structure such that the map F is a map of p-algebras. We have somehow the dual of this statement. If we start with a p-algebra structure on the object Y and X is cofibrant and the map is trivial fibration, then X admits a p-algebra structure such that F is a map of p-algebras. And if we assume that our objects are X and Y are fibrant and cofibrant, then it's enough to have a weak equivalence. So to be able to transport the p-algebra structure from X to Y and vice versa. So if X and Y are fibrant and cofibrant and F is a weak equivalence, any p-algebra structure on X induces one on Y and vice versa. Okay, let me show you how you can prove this, because it's just a lifting, it's the lifting properties of the category. So let's try to prove the second part. So we have a cofibrant object, Y is a p-algebra, and a map F from X to Y, which is a trivial fibration. And we want to put a p-algebra structure on X. So we consider the following diagram. So we know that Y is a p-algebra, so we have a map of operands from P to the endomorphism operand of Y. So this gives Y the structure of p-algebra. And then here we have the endomorphism operand of X. This is the endomorphism operand of Y. And this nxy has at level n is the internal home of X tensor n times with itself to Y. This is not an operand, so this is not an operand. It's just a collection, okay? So this doesn't have the structure of an operand. And in the category of collections, we have that this map here, this vertical map, is a trivial fibration. And this is because F is a trivial fibration and index, we call it nx n is from x times n into x. Okay, then by a joint version of the pushout product axiom of the model category, we have that this map is always a trivial fibration. Okay, then what we do is we take the pullback of this diagram. And we get something that I have denoted by nf, And this NF, although this is not an operand, as we said, since NY and NX are operands, this acquires the structure of an operand. And moreover, since this is a pullback of a trivial vibration, it is also a trivial vibration. Okay, so this is a trivial vibration. This vertical map is a trivial vibration of operands. Now we have that the operand P is cofibrant. This was one of the assumptions. It's a cofibrant object. We have a trivial vibration, so we can find a lift. And if we compose this lift together with this map here, we get a map from P into the endomorphism operator of X, which gives us the required P algebra structure on X. And having a map from P to this endomorphism operator of F is the same as saying that the map F is a map of P algebras because of this diagram. Okay, so this is essentially the proof in the second case, and the other two are very, very similar. Okay, so we have seen how to describe it, this setting the homotopy invariance property. And now I want to address this other question that I mentioned in the beginning, which is the rectification of algebras or of homotopy algebras. Okay, so first of all, in this case, we have to put a model structure in the category of P algebras for some operand P, and we are going to do it similarly as we did for operands. So we are going to transfer the model structure from an adjunction. In this case, we have a free forgetful adjunction. So from the category C to the category of P algebras in C. So the right adjunct is the forgetful. So we have an algebra. We just forget the algebra structure and we get an object in C. And the left adjoint is the free P algebra functor, which I have defined here. So we have an object X in C. The free P algebra is just we take the coproduct of the tensor of Pn over sigma n of X with itself n times. Okay, now the idea is the same as before. So we have a model structure on C and we want to transfer it to a model structure on the category of algebras. Okay. Now when we can do this, we say that the operand P is admissible. So if there exists a transfer model structure on the category of algebras, then we say that the operand P is admissible. So what does it mean for this model structure to exist? Well, it means that we have a model structure where a map of algebras is a weak equivalence or a fibration when it is so as a map of objects in C. So when we forget the algebra structure, we get map in C. So we ask this map to be a quick equivalence or a fibration. Okay. So examples when we can do this. So it can be proved that in the category of simplicial sets and the category of topological spaces, all operands are admissible. So whenever we have any operand in these categories, we have a model structure for the category of P algebras. In the category of chain complexes, the cofibrant operands are admissible. So we have to impose this cofibrancy condition. And in general, if we have a monoidal model category that satisfies the monoid axioms, then the cofibrant operands are admissible. Okay, so you see that cofibrant operators have nice properties, but it's a bit of a restricted class, so it's a bit too strict sometimes to have a cofibrant operator. So we're going to define a slightly larger class of operators which still have nice properties, and this is the class of sigma cofibrant operators. An operand is called sigma cofibrant when we take the underlying collection, if the underlying collection is cofibrant in the model structure for collections, which means that the map from the initial object to the operand is a cofibration, and the initial operand is defined as is the unit of the monoidal category and degree for RET1 and is zero in the others. Okay. So this is what a sigma cofibrin operator is. And then we can define what is for every operator, we can define the category of homotopy P algebras or algebras up to homotopy as the category of algebras over a cofibrin replacement of the operator P. Okay, so we fix P and the category of homotopy P algebras is this category as P tilde of C, where this P tilde is a cofibrin replacement of P. So we have a map from P tilde to P, which is a weak equivalence, and this P tilde, this operator P tilde is cofibrin. And we define a P infinity operator as a sigma cofibrin resolution of P. And sigma cofibrin resolution means that we have a map from P infinity to P, which is a trivial cofibration, so it's a fibration and a weak equivalence. And this map P infinity is sigma cofibrin. Well, some property that also holds is that this class of sigma cofibrin operators contains the class of cofibrin operators. So every cofibrin operator is sigma cofibrin. Okay, so we have the notion of the category of homotopy P algebras. And we have the notion of the category of algebras and the category of P infinity algebras. So we're going to compare these all these categories, right? So the first thing that we realize is that we have the following adjunction. If we have a map of operators from P to Q, we can always have take the base chain adjunction, which is so we have this adjunction between the category of P algebras and the category of Q algebras. The right adjoint is usually denoted by F upper star and the left adjoint by F lower shrink. And what is true is that if these categories of algebras admit the transfer model structure, so they have model structures, then this adjunction is a Quillen pair. Okay. And now the question is when is this a Quillen equivalence? Or what are the conditions that we have to impose in this map of operators to be a Quillen equivalence? So in principle, one we like to have that if F is a weak equivalence of operators, then the categories of algebras should be Quillen equivalent. Well, this is true, but we have to assume that the operators are sigma cofibrin. So the explicit statement is if F is from P to Q is a weak equivalence, and P and Q are sigma cofibrin operators, then this base chain adjunction is a Quillen equivalence. Quillen equivalence meaning that they have the same equivalent homotopy categories. Okay. And as a corollary of this, we can obtain the following, that the category, for every operator P, the category of P infinity algebras is Quillen equivalent to the category of homotopy P algebras. So, how can we prove this? Well, the idea is the following. So we take the operator P. We take this P tilde to define the category of homotopy P algebras. This P tilde is a cofibrin operator which is weakly equivalent to P. And then we take P infinity, which is sigma cofibrin resolution of P. So we have a trivial fibration, and P infinity is sigma cofibrin. Okay, now the map on the left is a trivial fibration, and this operator P tilde is cofibrin, so we are in a model structure, so we can find a lift. And since these two maps are weak equivalences, by 2 out of 3, this lift is also a weak equivalence. And this map P tilde is cofibrin, in particular, is sigma cofibrin, so this map here is a weak equivalence between sigma cofibrin operators, and then we can apply the previous statement, and we can apply this theorem that tells us that we have a Quillen equivalence between the categories of the corresponding algebras. In this case, one is the category of P algebras, and the other one is the category of homotopy P algebras. Okay. So we can define what in general what an infinity operat is. So this is nothing but a sigma covariant resolution of the associative operat, and an infinity operat is just a sigma covariant resolution of the commutative operat. Okay. So so how can we state the one of the results that I commented in the beginning? So the fact that every A infinity space can be rectified to a monoid. So in general, so we have that the operat S is admissible, and it is sigma cofibrin. Okay, so this means by the previous theorem that the category of A infinity algebras and the category of associative algebras, which is the category of monoids, are homotopy equivalents. So A infinity algebras may be rectified to monoids, and this holds in any monoidal model category which satisfies the assumptions to have a transfer model structure for operands. In particular, I will recover the result for topological spaces. Okay. Now, can we do the same for infinity? Well, the answer is no, because infinity is not sigma cofibrant. So we cannot apply this result. And we have that this is already false in, for instance, in topological spaces, because the commutative algebras are products of Eilenberg-Marlane spaces, and there are infinity spaces which are not of this form. So we cannot rectify infinity algebras in spaces, but we can rectify A infinity algebras. But we'll see that in other categories, for example, in the category of a spectra, we can rectify those. So we have rectification for A infinity and for E infinity too. Okay. And this is the last thing that I want to explain. So we saw that we cannot apply these transfer theorems to the category of a spectra because they cannot satisfy the conditions of the transfer. But can we get a model structure, a transfer model structure? Well, the answer is that yes, we can do that, but we need to use a kind of trick. So we have to use, first of all, we have to use color operats. So color operats are a generalization of operats, which as you can see, generalizes at the same time categories and operats. Sometimes color operats are also called symmetric multi-categories in the literature. And they can be defined as follows. So we have a closed symmetric monoidal category C, and we have any set C, which is going to be the set of colors. And a color operat, C color operat, consists of objects of the category C. And now we have an object for every n plus one tuple, C1, Cn, C. So you have to think of C1, Cn as well, you have to think of the elements of this object as operations. It's a bit like operats, but in this case, these operations, the inputs and so it has n inputs, and the output, which is C, are colored by the elements of the set C. So we have inputs of different colors or different sorts of different types, whatever you want to call it. Okay. For every n plus one tuple, we have objects, and then we have to add more structure. So first of all, we have the action of the symmetric group, which acts on each of these objects by permuting the inputs. We have units, which are maps from the unit of the monoidal structure to P from C to C, and this is for every color. We have a composition product, which is similar as the one for the usual operats, although it's a bit more involved. It also has to be associative and compatible with the sigma n actions and the units. So maybe it's better if I show a picture to see how this composition product goes. So suppose that we have a set with three colors. So this is a very, very simple example, but it's just to get the idea. And suppose that we have So I'm trying to describe the composition product. So we have an operation here. So this first operation, we have three inputs and one output. And these inputs are of different types. So the first is of color black, the last one is white, and the middle one is with stripes. Okay, and the output is color white. So now we have to tensor this, since we have three inputs, we have to tensor this with three operations. So we have these three operations. The first one has two inputs and one output, which are colored as in the picture. The second one has three inputs and one output. And the third one has one input and one output. Okay. So this is this object here. So it's an element in this object here. Okay. You can think of it as an operation with these colors as input and this color as output. So what do we do? So what we do is we just plug the outputs of these operations into the inputs of this one. So we can compose only when the output of the first operation coincides with the color of the output coincides with the color of the input of this operation, the color of this output operation coincides with this, and the color of this coincides with this one. Okay, and then what we get is we just plug this into the corresponding places, and we get an operation which has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 inputs of these colors, and an output which is color white. Okay. So as I said, this is a notion that generalizes both classical operas that describe and also categories. So an opera is a C-color opera with just one color. So all the operations are the inputs are of the same type and the output too. And if we have a colored operat with only unary operations, this is the same thing as a category. Okay. And the composition product of this color operat is precisely the composition of morphisms in a category. Okay. And the objects of this category is precisely the set C. Okay. So why do we want to generalize this notion of operats? Because with color operats we can describe many more structures than with just operas. Okay, and another thing is that so an algebra over a color over an operat, classical algebra, is just an object in the category. In this case, since we have these color operats, an algebra, they are defined similarly, but they live in this category. So we have. So an algebra for a color, for a C-color operat, P, will consist of a sequence of objects in C, so one object for each element in the set of colors. And as I said, we can encode many algebraic structures apart from the ones that we encode with operats. We have, for instance, we can have an operat, a color operat whose algebras are map of P algebras. We can codify it by modules, so a module with an action, left action and a right action of rings. We can also codify, for instance, diagrams of a fixed shape in the category. So there is an operat whose algebras are diagrams, and we can even codify operats and C-color operats for a fixed set of colors. So there is a color operat. So you have a category, monoideal category is a color operat in this category, whose algebras are precisely the operats in the category. Okay, and this example is what's going to be relevant to produce this model structure for symmetric spectra, for spectra. Okay, and of course, when we have this algebraic structure that we can codify with color operats, there is a notion of these structures up to homotopy. I mean, we can do the same. We can define we can put model structures on categories of color operas. We can take Cofibre replacement. We can take P infinity versions of these structures. So there is a lot of things that we can do here. Okay, so let's see how can we get this model structure for symmetric spectra. The category of symmetric spectra is a category which is tensor over simplicial sets. this means that we can have there is a functor which can have a simplicial set and a spectrum. We can multiply them, and then we get a spectrum. So whenever we have an action of a monoidal category in another monoidal category, it makes sense to consider operats in the enriching category and algebras in the base category. So in this case, it makes sense to have operats in simplicial sets acting on symmetric spectra, on spectra. So it means that we have operats in simplicial sets, but the algebras are going to take values in a spectra. Okay. And then we have the following theorem, which is due to Ehrenbender and Mandel, that if we take the category of symmetric spectra with the positive model structure, and we have an operat P in simplicial sets, so they prove that every operat, so no conditions on P, is admissible, which means that the category of P algebras in symmetric spectra always admits the transfer model structure. So it's a full model structure, and there are no conditions on P. So every operat, for every operat P in simplicial sets, is important. We have a transfer model structure. And moreover, they prove that if we have a weak equivalence of operats, simplicial operats in the category of operats in simplicial sets, and we take this base chain adjunction, this is always a Quillen equivalence. So we are only assuming again that this map F is a weak equivalence. So no sigma cofibrancy assumptions on P and Q. Okay. But this is very special for the category of symmetric spectra, and this is what is going to allow us to produce this model structure. Something is not working. Okay. So can you see my screen?
Yes. Yes.
So, yeah. I think that I have some problems because I cannot pass to the next slide. So let me try to.
I can't see it, but I can just see the previous slide.
Yeah, but I think it's. Can you see me, or I'm frozen in the image?
You're frozen too. Not that you say
yeah. Yeah. So I'm having some problems. Sorry. Maybe it's the keyboard, let me see. I'm sorry, but. Yeah, I cannot. But can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. But it seems that my computer is not responding, so. And also the keyboard. So maybe.
We can only hear you.
Okay, but maybe I will change to another computer. Let's see. Yeah, sorry for the problem. Let me see. So I'm trying to connect from another computer.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah, I don't know, it's not responding, so let me try to switch it off. One second. No, I cannot do that either. Okay.
Maybe you can stop sharing the screen and try to start it again.
Just wait a second, so. Okay.
And I said, now the sound is like interfering.
Yeah, is it okay now?
Now we still see the old part of your screen. So.
But now I'm connecting with another. I'm connected with another account.
Okay. Yes. Okay. I see your new account.
Okay, so let's see if I can share the screen.
Yeah, that's okay.
Yeah.
You see it now?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, sorry. But I have two tablets because I have to switch from one to the other. Okay, so where were I? Was I? Okay, yeah. So I was saying that for the category of symmetric spectra, you have this this very nice theorem that says that any weak equivalence without any assumptions on P and Q will give us a weak equivalence, a Quillen equivalence for the level of the categories of algebras. Okay, and for instance, you can use this to prove that in the spectra, A infinity and infinity algebras can be rectified to monoids and commutative monoids, respectively. Okay, so we saw that this is true for A infinity spaces, but it's not true for E infinity. But in a spectra, it's true for either A infinity and E infinity. And the last theorem, which is the I want to present, which is the result that we got together with Rainer Vogt, is that there is a transfer model structure in the category of operas in a spectra, and the trick to get it is to use this operat for this color operat for operats. Okay, so the proof is as follows. So first of all, you build a colored operat in sets in the category of sets, whose algebras are the operats in sets. So this is a color operat, and the set of colors you have to take the natural numbers. So an algebra will be an object for each n. So this will give us precisely an operat in sets. Now what you do is, So now what you do is you can transfer or transport any operating sets to an operat in any monoidal category using this strong monoidal factor. It's the factor from sets to C, which takes a set A to a coproduct of copies of the unit of the monoidal category indexed by A. So you take A copies of the unit. This is a strict monoidal factor, strong monoidal, and it sends operats to operats. Okay. So you can do this in particular for this operat op. And you can transport it to simplicial sets. Okay, so I denote it by op again. So this is the corresponding operat in simplicial sets, and then you make this operat act in symmetric spectra, and you get that the op algebras in a spectra are precisely the operats with values in a spectra. So the algebras over this operat are the operats in a spectra, and then you have to use this theorem by Elmendorf-Mandel that says that every operat, a simplicial operat in spectra, is admissible, and this will give you a transfer model structure on the category of algebras, of algebras, which is precisely the category of operats in symmetric spectra. You have to take the positive model structure for symmetric spectra, by the way. And you can also do this. So this is done for just operats, so classical operats in symmetric spectra, but you can do this also for colored operats, so for any set C. And well, this is the last thing that I want to explain. I'm sorry for the problems with the presentation at the end.
Okay, so thank you very much for the talk, and there is no problem with the presentation. Everything was okay, even with this short interruption. So now, are there any questions or comments for Javier? Fernando has one. Okay, Fernando, I think you were the first one.
Hi.
Hi, Fernando.
So my question was the following. You see, An opera is given by a, as you call it, a sequence or whatever, a collection. And the collection consists of spaces, say, if we're thinking of topological spaces, each of which carries the action of a finite group. And we have a notion of equivariant homotopy theory for spaces with an action of a group. I remember that in the thesis of,
Resk.
Of Resk, yeah, exactly. There was a model structure taking into account those equivalences, right? So the equivariant weak equivalences.
Yes.
Is there anything done in that direction for the model categories?
Yes, I mean, what you are asking is also, so for, the thing is that you want to change the model structure on the category of collections. Okay, so the one that I took was the product model structure of the projective in its category C to the sigma n. I took the projective, but you can take the equivariant model structure, for instance, for spaces. Okay, so you can try to use this transfer theorem in this case, and in several cases it works. So for topological spaces it works, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
So it's possible to.
Yeah, I didn't know. So, do you have any reference for that? Because I've always been curious about it. For me, it's a natural thing to think of.
I think you already mentioned Resk's thesis for that. So I think there's something there. And there's also something that I did together with David White. We wrote a paper on equivariant stuff for operas and algebras. I think there's some statements there too that maybe you can find.
Okay.
But it's possible. It's possible, yes.
Okay, thanks, Javier.
Okay, so we have further question of Renato.
Hi. I was just wondering, you can use the theory of algebraic model structures to generalize transfer theorems for contexts where the model structure is not necessarily cofibrantly generated. I was just wondering if you're aware of any method using this or something else to define a mixed model structure on topological operands.
What do you mean by a mixed model structure?
In topological spaces, you have the strong model structure where you have the vibrations are Couric vibrations instead of
vibrations. Yes.
Are you aware of any way to get on? A model structure on topological operands where the vibrations are Couric vibrations instead of Cf vibrations.
You could try to transfer from the mixed model structure on topological spaces and see if that works.
I think using algebraic model structures that could work, but I wasn't aware if anyone ever actually wrote down everything. I was wondering if you knew.
No, I don't know. I don't know.
Thank you.
Okay, so Victor, have you got?
Yeah, thank you very much, Javier, for the talk. And I have three little questions. The first one is just that if the transfer of PR algebra structure works, if you consider only the semi-model a structure given by Spitzwegs.
Yeah. So yes, I forgot to mention this, but the answer is yes. But you need to assume that the operand P is sigma cofibrant. So it doesn't. I think it doesn't work in general. But if you just assume that P is sigma cofibrant, then you can transfer from you have a semi-model transfer semi-model structure on P algebras.
But even in this general framework, cofibrant implies sigma cofibrant, no?
Yes, yes. But you have it, I mean, you have it for cofibrant, but you also have it for sigma cofibrant, which is a slightly bigger class. So,
okay.
But then if it's sigma cofibrant and it's not cofibrant, then what you get is a semi-model structure instead of a full model structure.
Okay, right. And the two more questions, I have two more. The first one is that you consider Werner and Mordick consider a Hopf interval to construct several model structures for operands. Does this structure coincide with what you need to do the Bormann-Vogt W construction?
Yes. So there is also some so the W construction of Foreman and Fock can be also generalized to arbitrary monoidal model categories. And for that you need an interval. Yes. So one of the inputs of this construction is an interval. So this is done in one of the papers by Berger and Mutek.
So the assumption of having a Hof Oberrad, interval, yeah. Yes, to construct the homotopy theory, also is given.
It's an ingredient of the W construction. Yeah, of this formal or general W construction. Yes.
Ah, okay. And the last one is that I'm more used to see the construction or the admissibility of operads by means of the transfer model structure for all operads, not in the direction that you explained, that you have admissibility for certain operads proven by I don't know how, and then you use it to prove that operads in itself admit a model. So what's the how do the Elmendorf and Mandel prove the admissibility without using the model structure in operads?
Well, because you can you can define a model structure for algebras without for P algebras without a model structure for operads. So because you have this, you know, you have this adjunction from this free forgetful adjunction. So you have a model structure on, let's say, category C, and then you're going to transfer it to a model structure on the category of algebras. So for that, I mean, in principle, you don't need a model structure on operads. But what they do is very particular for symmetric spectra, and is very particular of the positive model structure. So I don't think that it works in general. So the results that they get are very good, but they only work in this very particular case.
They handle the.
I mean, in fact, in their paper, they give the. I mean, they prove that all operas are admissible, but they don't say anything about a model structure for operas in a spectra. So they only talk about model structure for P algebras, where P is a simplicial operat, and the algebras are in symmetric spectra, which is, I mean, for instance, is enough if you want to just consider infinity structures or infinity structures.
Yeah, I know. But they handle, you mean they handle precisely the generators to construct the transfer model structure for algebras.
No, but they don't. I don't think they use the transfer. I mean, no, it's not. I mean, you cannot apply the transfer because of the reasons that I mentioned. They. I mean, they constructed by, let's say, by hand. So they prove that this is a model structure. I mean, you just know what the vibrations and the weak equivalences have to be, and then you just have to check the axioms. I think that's what they do, if I remember correctly.
But they are Coffee-Brenly generated.
Yes. Oh. Yes.
Surprising. Well, thank you very much, Javier, again.
Thank you.
Okay, so any other question?
Mm-hmm. I have one question. Hi.
Hi.
I have two questions. The first is about the cofibrations in operad categories. For example, let's say we work with topological operads, and cofibrations are a bit implicit because you defined by the lifting property.
Yes.
Is there something like a set of generating cofibrations or some principle that allows you to recognize that a map is a cofibration?
Well, the transfer principle gives you a cofibrillary generated model structure. So so the generating cofibrations and trivial cofibrations are the image under the free functor of the generating cofibrations and trivial cofibrations of the base category.
Okay. Okay.
So so yes. So you have, I mean, you know what the sets of generating fibrations and cofibrations and trivial cofibrations are.
Okay, thank you. And so also the I was wondering if there is an explicit construction of the cofibrant replacement in, for example, in the topological setting.
Well, as I mentioned to Victor, there is a W construction which you can perform in quite generally, which gives you a cofibrant or sigma cofibrant replacement of an operat. So this is the most explicit, let's say, construction that I know of.
Okay, thank you very much.
So any other questions or comments? No? Okay, so if not, let's thank Javier for his talk. Okay, so thank you once more. Meet you next Tuesday at 4 p.m. for the next talk.